with Dick and I and, you know, just being concerned. Welcome to the Town of Deerfield Select Board meeting on May 25th, 2016 at 7 p.m. Down here at the South Deerfield Village Town Hall. I apologize, we're a little bit late. We had a meeting prior to this. So we'll skip right down to Kelly and Pink and Company here.
Well, good evening. We are here primarily tonight to introduce Matt Perotti. He is our clerk of the works and will be on site daily starting June 16th. Matt has had some vigorous training this week with Pink and Company to come on board, and then he'll physically be on site. We've already coordinated a spot for him with Marty and her staff in the school, so we're ready to rock and roll. We'll have him here on site June 13th. We expect to mobilize MDM engineering. The GC will mobilize fencing, their storage containers, that sort of thing. In conjunction, we'll be collaborating with Bob Lesko to make sure that he understands dates and gives us the approval. So just kind of cording off the outside of the building on the 15th of June, which is a Wednesday, in preparation to start construction on the 20th of June, as we've always been teeing up. So right now, just to give a quick update of the process, we've collaborated with Dick and RDA and Pink and MDM on the permit status and the process, and we're very close to getting our permit resolved. RDA owed two more documents to Dick and...
Okay, I'll give you the quick update. RDA...
I'm going to interrupt you because I just want to make sure it's on the record that I really appreciate Kelly meeting with Dick and I to resolve some of our concerns and my concerns in particular. So I really appreciate it. That was very nice. And I'll let Dick get into it, but I was happy to see that most everything was resolved since we met
a week ago.
So thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Okay. Real simple from my part. I've talked to Kelly many times this week on the phone. I've talked to RDA and their engineering guy, Jeff Yost, and he's agreed to every single thing I've asked for. He's giving me every single document I've asked for.
So you have all the paperwork.
I will have all the paperwork.
Okay. We should have it by the end of this week.
By the end of the week,
not
yep.
Tuesday the latest.
It's not a problem. He was very, very receptive to the weekly meetings and the minutes of the meetings and et cetera, et cetera. So we are 100% on track. As soon as the actual document is on my desk, I will immediately issue the permit. No holdup. And then I'll skip over to our clerk of the works. He's done several jobs in town. I know him very well. I believe he will be very competent in fulfilling this job, and I think right now the way the team is set up, I think that there's not going to be any glitches here at all. I think somebody's thumb will be on everything, whether it's her thumb or my thumb or Matt's thumb. They will be on that. The three of us will be dictating how that construction is done.
Kelly, thank you though. Okay. I was very concerned about the weekly meetings and to have that resolved and have weekly
Absolutely.
Meetings.
Yeah.
Yep. We took what we heard at the meeting and
thank you.
You know, made sure that that got turned around very quickly.
That was huge. Did you have any issues that you wanted to
No,
bring?
I was going to ask Matt where he was from and what his experience was, but I'm...
No, go ahead. We've already done that.
My name is Kip Kamosa, and I was just wondering, you know, where are you from and what's your background in the construction?
I live in Greenfield all my life, and been doing my own business since about 99, and it took off really big when we started working down in Deerfield about 6 years ago, and working close with Mr. Kalicheski over there, and learns a lot from him and how he likes things done. So,
he's actually built four houses in the past 2 years in Deerfield.
So not only has he oversaw such projects, but he's also been in the field installing such projects. So he has, correct me if I'm wrong, but installations of roofing in his repertoire. So he's actually been the guy on site
So now to oversee that application, we thought was, you know, teed
was
up for.
Was it primarily residential roofing, or have you been involved with this panelized connections to the metal decking like proposed at this elementary school?
Mainly residential roofing. I've been over the prints, and, you know, we've done similar, not in a commercial fashion, but, you know, the overall applications.
Okay. I think, Kip, the answer to that part of the question is, I think this particular design is only a handful or a few. I don't know, Kelly might know, but I don't believe there's that design has done that very many buildings of this magnitude. It's a fairly new design concept, so as you well know.
Yep.
So, but I believe that Matt has the experience to understand how a screw needs to be put in, for example, whether it's recessed too far or not enough, and if there are enough. I think he has that background, that the same as you would if you got up on a roof, you'd understand. So.
So his detail-oriented presence and, you know, his leadership and abilities to lead teams and understand a challenge, and plus the rapport that he has with Dick, for us was a slam dunk to bring him on board this team. So you know, we plan on having, you know, he'll do his daily reports, he'll take his photos every day. We've commiserated with Doug and said that we would take those daily reports and then kind of take it in a layman's term and write it in a less detailed fashion, but still communicate where we are in the project, so that way we can send it over to Doug for him to post to your website weekly, just to give, you know, everybody the sense of how well the project is progressing week to week. There was one other point that I wanted to make. We brought him on board. You might say, why is he here in May? We brought him on board to get comfortable with the drawings, to get comfortable with the design team, to ask questions. So in his past experience, if he's not familiar with the system like you're talking about, we have the ability now to go back and forth with Jeff and make sure that he's got it built in his head before it actually gets built in the field. So, I mean, we have countless amounts of meetings, and that's kind of my update. We're in the paperwork minutia part of the project. We'll build it on paper 10 times before you see the roof products here on site. So that's what we're doing. That's Pink's part of that process. We have the PFA is executed as well with the MSBA. So that's a big milestone. We're now working on the ProPay system and getting the schedule values entered into the system there. And you know, the color, you had asked about the color for the shingles.
I was just curious.
This is the color that was selected by a committee, a small committee that made that selection. So I want to bring that as follow-up.
Thank you.
I sent him.
Maybe the camera can focus in on that.
Oh.
Can you point to it again?
Just hold it straight up. There it is.
The dark.
Zoom in, Chris.
Yeah. Okay, great. Thank you.
It's called Weathered Slate.
Okay,
and it's
perfect.
GAF is the manufacturer, Slate Line is the product, and then Weathered Slate's the color. So, and I believe, Doug, I sent you a PDF on this color.
Oh, great.
I think I did. So that, in closing comments, we you know, have Matt on site. I will be here at the weekly meetings and periodically here as well, overseeing the project. We still have Tommy Chan back in our Boston office, who's familiar with the ProPay system and the MSBA, you know, systems and so forth. So he's a good right-hand man. He probably won't be to the site. It'll be myself and Matt. And then, you know, the next meeting we'll get with Doug and see how often you guys want us here at these meetings. And, you know, with producing the weekly report, I want to make sure that we're servicing, you know, where we're at and what we're doing to the degree that you want from us. So we'll figure out a time schedule on when you want us here based on your summer, every couple weeks, and go from there.
I think, like I expressed, my main concern was that we had the paperwork right from the beginning, and that Dick was very comfortable that all the paperwork was filed correctly right from the beginning and organized. And if he's satisfied, then I'm satisfied. And I think Kip is going to be involved a little bit on this too, and we wanted to get it done successfully, but then never have to come back and revisit this either. So, at least until I'm in the grave, maybe. So,
if you'd like, I can coordinate any information needs to be passed on, I can give it to Kip, so he'll be able to contact you and
Billy. Well, it just...
I know you don't do roofs.
Well, I'm... you know, it's not that I'm going to add a lot to the process. I just want the process to be organized and set up and be successful so that if there's any issues, we can go right back to the architect. You know, we talked about the concerns.
Right.
And we want to make sure everything, you know, the warranty's no issue and yes. anything like that.
One question that when we had our meeting last week, you guys had talked about was the closeout process. I sent Dick a copy of what the MSBA requires for closeout documentation, and we're following that, plus the closeout requirements in the contract document. Yeah. So I feel with those two blended together, you're, you know, as a town, you are covered.
Yeah. And well, if the file's set up, you know, so that anyone can go in there 5 years from now, 10 years from now, and be able to access the file successfully, that's what we're looking for. Right. Marty, did you have anything you'd like to add to it, or...
No, I think Kelly's been great in making sure that the school is aware of the schedule and when they're going to be fencing the perimeter, when teachers have to be out. So she has a meeting tomorrow. She's going to update me on that, and I will let the school staff know. So I think we're pretty much on schedule. The only thing we can't control is the weather, and we will be very hopeful that we'll have a fairly dry summer.
Is there going to be not? There won't be access to the playgrounds, right?
No.
Okay, so
we all fenced off. There will be no access to the playground.
Okay, so maybe we can put on the website that effective, whenever the fencing goes up, June 16th or whatever.
The fifteenth is when the fence goes up.
Yeah,
it's a Wednesday.
Yep.
It'll be the day after school ends.
If you could just put a reminder on the website that. The playgrounds are fenced off, because I know there's a lot of activity over there since they've been upgraded, and that we will make it people aware, or we will let people know when the fencing comes down and then they have access to the playgrounds again.
Yeah, and even the pavilion that's kind of behind the school, I wouldn't want people there either.
Yeah, so that. We'll just put it on the across the website and... Maybe we can hang something on the door.
Well, we have a site logistics plan again. There's some minor details and tweaks that we're just going over with the contractor tomorrow to make sure that it's staged correctly and presented correctly.
I just know that there's like some homeschooling kids and different,
right?
I mean, other communities come in sometimes and use the, because it's a lovely playground, and I certainly, it's wonderful that people use it, but I think we just need to clarify that it won't be accessible. And we don't want people there for safety reasons.
The whole site, Carolyn, is going to be basically off limits to sightseers and non-workers.
Yep. Well, I know that, you know, Marty's put a lot of effort into moving the summer programs and making sure people are aware that, you know, it won't. I mean, usually there's activity year-round there, and that just is not going to happen.
My closing comment is my main focus is going to be on the construction, quality of construction, in making sure the warranty is done so it's enforced and we get the correct paperwork for that in the future.
And I very much appreciate that, because you know that's been my big bugaboo concern.
Monitoring the payment schedules and stuff is not in my cards.
Okay. No, but it seems like, Kelly, I appreciate it, because it seems like you're on top of that, and that's equally as important, because obviously it affects our schedule for, you know, borrowing money and getting reimbursed and stuff. So it's huge. So thank you.
And then we are.
Excuse me. Do we currently have the language of the warranty?
It's in the spec book, like what's required. Okay. Yes.
I was going to say, if you want something. I believe I've got a copy of that in my office.
Yeah. I know we looked at it.
Each section has, there's components of the warranties. There's the shingle warranty, then there's the fascia warranty, there's the metal air warranty.
There's always a last question, but is the guy coming back from the shingle manufacturer to be on site?
Yes, I believe that's part of.
Then we could have Kip meet him when he comes back next time. And you can.
Yeah, I mean, we can request that they come to the next meeting, the 15th.
I don't really want to waste a lot of time with this, but, you know, I'm hoping that the warranty, I heard this by watching one of the meetings, that it's a package type warranty, and it's a performance type warranty of the roof system, not of the individual components. because if it's a warranty of the individual components, we're in trouble to get go. Because if we have the same issues that we've had before, the manufacturer's going to come back and say, look, there's nothing wrong with the shingles. They're fine. Everybody along the lines will say their product functions properly, and they're all going to point the fingers, well, now that we have the ice dam and the water is just backing up under the shingles. The shingle manufacturers will say, our product's made to repel the shingles as it flows downhill, not against backups. So, you know, that's why I'd like to just read the warranty. And
Can we ask RDA to follow up on that and get that? I have your email, so... I'll follow up on that and get that to you.
It's just, you know, it's our intention that once the leaks are, I mean, we don't have a leaky roof anymore. We're going to fix some of this stuff. And, you know, you wouldn't want to have another leaky roof again. So we went all over this, Kelly, so I'm not harassing you. I'm just, you know, obviously we're a little nervous about it.
I mean, the paperwork, like I said, building it on paper first and then closing it out. Most of the stuff that we build on paper first provides you with your end result anyway, but there's a lot of the stuff that there needs to be site visits and, you know, documentation that yes, they've performed and they've installed per manufacturer's recommendations. Matt's going to be overseeing that, and then at the end, you package that together. So, but let me get this answer to you. I'm actually heading on vacation in the next couple of days.
You
so
just came back from vacation.
I will.
The last time we had a meeting, you
no, that was home. Jeff. Jeff's been on like 40 vacations during this job. This is my first. Okay. So.
Okay.
All right. Well, Dick said I'm done. So.
Give her a time limit.
Obviously, I'm always available if anyone has any questions. Our next site meeting is June 15th as well, where we collaborate as a group between the town, the architect, Pink, and then the contractors.
If you need your cell phone number, I've got it.
Yep. Always available.
Yeah, no, I have it now, too. And I will track you down. No, just to make sure, so you're starting June 20th. You're going to do the 4 12-hour days, and then because of weather, you have the option of doing Fridays.
Yeah.
Are there any options of doing weekends if we have a bed?
Absolutely. Yep.
Okay.
Yep, absolutely. And so the way the spec is written, the Saturday is a makeup day as well, and then Sunday we just want to be, if we know, like on a Friday, we'll want to commiserate with the police chief and make sure that we get the approval to work on a Sunday.
Okay.
But it could be 7 days a week should the weather go astray on us.
That's okay. All coordinated already, Carol.
Okay. Yeah. I'm just checking. I just didn't ask that question.
Yeah, I mean, we'll be looking at the weather forecast, you know, come every Sunday, trying to forecast what's going to happen, you know, if we're getting weather like this.
And that's fine.
Yeah.
Did you have any other questions?
I'm good.
And the way they've got it sequenced, it can be kind of panelized in sections, so you can weather tight a section every night. And make sure then you're coming in the next day and
well, that,
stripping.
You know, I felt
you're
much better when you
roof.
Showed me the, you had worked out the sections with Dick.
Yep.
And that each section was going to be checked. And
that's all done.
Okay. Yep. No, it was a relief to know that that's what you had planned to do, and I appreciate that.
Yep.
I told you, I was much, much calmer after our meeting, and I, you know, really appreciate everything that was still not resolved has been resolved, and I just want to thank you very much.
I like checking the box, so.
Well, I mean, I appreciate you listening. I appreciate this is a lot of money for us, and we want to make sure we have a quality product that will last, and so I really appreciate you addressing all our concerns.
Okay.
Because I feel like our concerns were legitimate, but you listened, and according to Dick, you've resolved everything, so I really appreciate it.
All right, well, thank you, and we will see you guys. Have a wonderful Memorial Day weekend. And
right.
Kip will try
nice
to get this
Matt.
Information.
And yes, it was nice meeting you too, Matt.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Kathy, did you have something that you wanted to talk to us about?
Yes. I didn't know if you had like a public...
Well, we...
Yeah, right now.
Yeah, we can... I mean, we try to accommodate anybody, so...
Okay.
Just step right up.
Come on up.
Step right up.
Issues?
Well, I got the first one is to address is the one we got in the letter in the mail today from the town administrator about the beautification of South Deerfield.
Yeah, that was going to be part of my report, but I'm happy to talk about that now.
Sure.
Okay.
There's
I guess I really
find that. Can I ask a couple questions and then, or do you want me to, you want to go first?
Let me offer 10 seconds worth of description.
I was just going to say, let me hear what he has to say because I'm not really sure.
There's an effort afoot. There's a number of volunteers that are coming from Yankee Candle Company, anywhere from 15 to 35. We're not sure yet. That will be working with some of our folks at the Senior Center. Some of the folks at the highway department and any other volunteers out there in the world, hopefully in coordination with a lot of folks, to do some downtown beautification on Flag Day, June 14, coming up.
That's really nice.
We are working to reach out to the South Deerfield Women's Club to get coordination with them in regard to the town common. We've already been in touch with Sarah Woodbury in regard to what's happening around the library. Of course, Marlene Johnson has been involved with planning some activities for the Senior Center. And then we're looking also at the Bloody Brook Monument at halfway up North Main Street. And we issued a letter, which is the one you got, looking for donations of either materials or money that can help to support the project.
Okay. Well, that's wonderful. I didn't actually, Kathy, I didn't know anything about it. So.
So I said something to Kip, and he didn't know anything about it either. No, so my question was, I don't know when's the last time, I think I saw you in Jerry's this morning, but the last time you were in town, that the Bloody Brook Monument looks beautiful. Mm-hmm. The town common looks beautiful. I think it's all done for Memorial Day. Everything is planted.
Yep.
I don't know what more you're wanting to do. I happened to talk to Diane earlier, and she said that she tried at one place the planters. Mm-hmm. And so one of her questions and one of mine would be, who's going to be responsible to watering those planters?
Well, that's part of the coordination that we needed to we need to sit down with folks from the South Deerfield Women's Club, I guess it is, that's done taking the lead on the South Deerfield Town and, Common.
And Bloody Brook, too.
And the Bloody Brook, fair enough. Okay. Yeah. So we do. We were going to coordinate our efforts with the Women's Club to make sure that, A, that we're doing things that make sense and that complement the work that's been done there up to this point, but B, that all the details have been worked out.
Yes.
Marlene Johnson was supposed to be reaching out to Diane today to set up a quick conversation to talk about that. So.
Yeah, like I said, I had talked to her, and she, you know, because I read her the letter, she hadn't received it. I don't know if, you know, the bus company received one or not. She wasn't sure. She hadn't gone through the mail, but,
I'm not sure.
You know, that would be one of my concerns, too, was the planters and all that. And the other thing was, just a note, Broadway Farm has always been in Deerfield, and it's 01342, and I don't know why you got 01 South Deerfield in the wrong zip code, but.
I didn't put the list together. I apologize.
Okay.
So there we are.
All right, and so the other thing was, we do a lot of walking in town. And very observant. We walk with a bunch of ladies that, you know, walk through the Newtown Garage area, old Oxford Pickle site, and really concerned that we have this beautiful $6 million building, and it looks like a dump out there. And, you know, really the old garage, other than the building knocked down, there's not a lot of stuff that's been cleaned up. I know the town wants to market the site. I have no idea where you are on that. And if, you know, the old saying, when you want to sell a house or your property, you clean it up, and it just seems to be getting worse back there, then to me is necessary when we have places in town like the landfill where we could be putting some of this stuff and, you know, just cleaning it up. They seem to have cleaned up one section but moved it to another. And I don't know when the last time was you were back there. But you ought to try walking through.
It's been a while, so
yes.
I will.
And, you know, and you consider the condition of the sidewalk, the cement is coming up, you know, flecks of it's coming up.
Where?
The sidewalk coming into the town garage.
Really?
On Merrigan Way.
Okay. Or whatever the name of it is now, I have no idea. And, like I said, just really concerned about the looks of that
That's
site.
Brand new.
Hmm?
I said, that's brand new. That's
I know,
terrible.
But it's, you know, the grass didn't come back. It's all weeds. It's just not, to me, walking through and seeing the town put all that money and time into that building. and having it look that way and the site look that way, you'd think to sell it that you would want to improve the site, and which I thought that was one of the intent of the garage, was improving the site. And the other thing we notice as we walk around town, especially me, is kind of my pet peeve, is a lot of dead trees not removed. And it's not just 1 year, it's been several years. And I know we've had one removed in front of our house with a lot of nagging from Steve. And the town used to replace trees. I don't know when the last time a tree was planted in this town. And I guess I kind of have issues with that because, one, I like to keep the trees growing. It takes, when you take out one, you should replace it. And the fact that, you know, I don't know what your reasoning was to do away with the tree warden. And
the tree warden still exists.
Yeah, we do have a tree warden, but there's no money. It's one of the line items that keeps getting cut.
But
I know it's not an investment.
I mean, it's, you know,
it's not,
I mean,
a good investment.
Read in the paper, greening
town.
Greenfield, all these other towns putting the, you know, I would rather see this money spent and purchasing trees to replace trees. And some of the trees, like I said, are along walkways. They're hazards. I'd be afraid. You know how many people in this town have gotten killed by falling limbs? And it's just, you know, it's a really big concern.
Kevin actually put in the budget this year to what it would cost to remove the trees. And we are going to follow through with it this year.
Okay. You don't see that on the line item in the budget when you... you know, at town meetings. So,
Jeff, do you remember? Was how much was Kevin's full amount approved for a tree?
Tree work?
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember off the top of my head. We had made a lower recommendation as far as finance committee, but all our recommendations were overridden at the town meeting, and I can't remember the exact number that was voted.
I know we... I'll
tell you in a moment.
I know it has been a concern about tree removal, so... Mm-hmm.
Kevin has addressed that and will be addressing
yeah.
that.
Yeah, and so...
discussions on how to be able to supply additional man hours to the tree work.
Yep, and we had... there was a little bit of tension between the select board and the finance committee on that line item because... we do get complaints, but also you just walk around or drive around and you can see these dead trees that have not been removed.
Mm-hmm.
But
like I said, my part of it is safety concern too, because, you know, it's been dry. When it's dry and hot, there's more wind.
Well, and we have storms. We have microbursts now that we
yes.
never, the,
mm-hmm.
the, or the percentage of microbursts that we had, we never, you know, you might get one in the summer. Now we get like five or six, you know,
mm-hmm.
so it's a lot different than it used to be. Trees are much more at risk.
Right. And like I said, once I got this, I think this this letter and the beautification of the, you know, the South Deerfield Common, it's the town of Deerfield, I guess, too. And I also, well, you also walk the sidewalks of Old Deerfield once a week, and they're a hazard. And I know some of it's from the trees, the roots and all that, but I don't know. It just seems like we try to do a lot with the private schools. And when you drive through Hatfield, and they had all their sidewalks redone, they're beautiful. And you walk in Old Deerfield, and you want people to come to our town, and this is what they see. I mean, a handicapped person in a wheelchair couldn't go down the sidewalks in Old Deerfield because they're in such bad shape. And it's terrible. There's a section that's totally missing. It's not even there. You can't even walk there. It's mud when there's any kind of rain. And to me, I live in the town of Deerfield. I don't distinguish. And I just hate to see all the stuff for the beautification of the downtown and just assuming that Deerfield Academy, Eagle Brook, and everybody else is going to take care of the other end of town.
I know,
it's east and west and old and...
I know.
South and the whole nine yards.
It is our responsibility.
So, like I said, this was one of my concerns, and this is what brought it all with the tree part of it and the fact that the, you know, try walking the town. I walk it every week, all the streets and everything else, and to see But we keep buying the equipment to fix things, and I don't know, you know, I don't see it being used. I don't see we buying them, making the right purchases or putting the money in the right places to do what needs to be done.
Actually, I disagree, but we are, you're making totally legitimate suggestions, and I know Kevin is aware of them, and I know Kevin is trying to address them because they are concerns of mine.
Mm-hmm.
We've been trying to do the sidewalk work for a few years,
mm-hmm.
and the sidewalks have been in bad condition for a while. Mm-hmm. This is not new.
Mm-hmm.
So we're hoping to do better.
Carolyn, if you'd like, I can request that Kevin provide a report on these issues for the next meeting.
Yeah, that would be nice.
Okay.
So when would the next meeting be? Because I'd like
week,
to
next
be
Wednesday.
Oh, next Wednesday. You don't meet every 2 weeks, so it'll be next Wednesday.
I okay. do also have one comment, though. The towns you're comparing us to with Deerfield now, a lot of those towns receive state grant money.
So why aren't we applying for that?
We don't qualify.
Why don't we qualify?
Supposedly we're too rich.
Oh, we're too rich?
And that's what happens on several of these, because I've asked that question
okay.
several times on other issues,
mm-hmm.
and it comes down to how they view Deerfield as okay. far as our financial state compared to some of the other towns.
Okay.
So, unfortunately, mm-hmm. not being able to qualify for some of those grants, I think Greenfield qualifies for some of the block grants, I believe they're called.
Yes, community block grants. You have to have a certain income
well
level
mm-hmm. for that type of work. And I think some of the other communities also,
mm-hmm.
unfortunately, we fall in a situation where we don't. And obviously,
except
with our
heart.
Budget, mm-hmm. it's a stretch it as far as you can in
right.
priorities.
Oh, I totally
and
understand.
You do the best you can.
Totally understand.
And not trying to make
right, I know,
issues.
But like I said, I do pay a lot of taxes in this town, too. We've been
yeah.
here for years, and just to
yeah.
see the way it's deteriorating and where our money's and how our money's being spent really is an issue for me. So,
well, all I can say is we've had a tough time in the last few years covering our operating expenses, and we're doing better this year.
Mm-hmm.
And 17, this budget that we just voted is actually better than this year. So I'm hoping that some of these items can be addressed. And we did no capital investment for a couple of years. This is just what we were talking about, our capital mm-hmm. investment. We're trying to correct that because for a couple of years we didn't put one single dollar out because we couldn't. We didn't have the money. And, we're trying very hard to stay within the 2.5%.
Mm-hmm.
And you know we're getting squeezed, and we're getting squeezed, and we're an override to do some of these things could resolve that, but mm-hmm. We're trying
one,
not.
One
to
thing I'd like to throw out there though is that in the past year, the select board has taken the first steps towards perhaps qualifying for more money for public works projects, and that's through the adoption of the community compact. And the adoption of the Complete Streets Initiative, and we are a couple of steps
streets
into
that. Policy. And
exactly,
done a lot of
adopting
stuff.
That initiative, building the policy that sets us up to begin to look for design grants, which can then set us up for grant money to be able to do these repairs. I would like to remind folks that over the past 15 years or so, there's been two separate studies for upgrading sidewalks and making at least the South Deerfield Common area, the broader area of South Main, Sugarloaf, Elm, and North Main, more walkable, more accessible, more friendly to people on bicycles and on foot. And that plan is in my office, and anybody's welcome to look at it at any time.
How was that funded?
The Complete Streets studies were funded through grants, I believe.
Yes.
I believe. Those plans are now collecting dust. We never took the next steps, which was to basically make some decisions about designs and get shovel-ready plans put together.
So who's responsible for making that next step, I guess?
The select board. But it also has to be budgeted,
mm-hmm.
and we didn't have the money to do it. So...
Is it something that the Capital Improvement Committee's aware of?
It is, and it's not on our Capital Improvement Plan because it's tens of thousands of dollars. But
the CIPC doesn't directly deal with public works anyways, with so-called horizontal construction,
well,
roads and sidewalks. CIPC is more concerned with maintaining or upgrading vertical construction, buildings, mm-hmm. structures, and the equipment that's inside it.
But this was to change, you know, like...
To cut off
expand,
that little...
Yeah, expand the public common and,
yep.
you know, doing those kind of things.
Right,
and,
right. I remember all that happening. I believe me, I've yep. been on enough of committees in this town where things get...
It was
decided,
really, it was
but then
really
it doesn't
important.
Go any further.
Right.
Collects dust.
It was really important to do the walkability, sociability, and we have some initial plans that I think are pretty good. And the, mm-hmm. and you know, we're Doug has been working on this on the side, trying to get this started, and hopefully, mm-hmm. hopefully we'll get some money to do it. We talked about it a couple weeks ago, actually, and before that, it was just about a month or so ago when we were, before town meeting, we were talking about trying to institute some of the striping when we have to restripe the streets to do some of the striping that allowed for the bicycle lanes and mm-hmm. that kind of thing. So it gives you the perception of a little bit more cozy.
Well, I don't know if anybody's been to the intersection by Dunkin' Donuts in Greenfield where they put the bike lane in the middle.
Yeah.
Which makes absolutely no sense because that person on the bike has to come from the right-hand side
yep.
and go all the way across traffic to
yep.
get to the middle lane.
Yep.
To me, that seems like
yep.
a
Scary.
Death trap to that person on a bicycle.
That
and
is,
then where do they go?
That is, and some say that that is actually appropriate because bicycles are supposed to obey all of the rules
oh,
of the road.
I understand that.
At the same time, when I was learning to ride a bike, one of the rules I learned was when you come to an intersection, you get off the bike and you become a pedestrian and you cross at the crosswalk.
Mm-hmm.
Walk your bike across, then you get back on your bike. Mm. But
to me, that's like,
yeah,
oh my gosh.
It seems odd. It seems contradictory.
Very odd.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very dangerous for the biker.
Sure.
Because there's nowhere for it to go once you get through
yep.
the intersection.
Yep.
So it's like, I don't agree well, 100% with the mass.
We're hoping that we can get some mass works projects, money, and different things like that to work downtown.
So I'm assuming there's grants, but are they matching grants, Doug, or are they grants that...
There's both.
If we're talking about Mass Works grants, if the project is accepted, if the project is ready to go, many times it's a 100% grant. In the case of the River Road construction, that was the case. That was entirely a full grant. In other cases, there may be smaller amount grants that do require a match at various percentages. And in other cases, it could be a low-interest long-term loan.
Mm-hmm.
that the town could qualify for,
okay.
which may help us out. But
so
we have to look into that.
I have to comment. I really enjoyed the way the town meeting was presented and the way the warrants and everything was explained and the recommendations. And it was very easy to follow this year. So I have to commend whoever decided how to do it that way. I really enjoyed it and made it.
Well, we're gonna work on our information night again and have Doug and take advantage of Doug's graphics where he talks about trends and mm-hmm. and it puts things on the line because I think what happens is people's eyes just glaze over after a while with just the numbers. So we're trying to do well for this next year. We'll try to do more pictures and graphs and
mm-hmm.
stuff like that in our information night so people have some time to absorb where we're going.
Mm-hmm.
We're trying to coordinate things. We have been meeting on the five-year plan to get our five-year plan, capital plan, so people have an idea of why there isn't a lot of extra money and what we're planning for to replace things. And
'cause
mm-hmm. like you said, I mean, things... It would be nice to have to address more of the pretty things and not just infrastructure stuff, because a lot of the infrastructure stuff... You don't see, and that sucks up a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be nice to have a chance to do some of the more pretty superficial things that are really make the difference between really how nice everything looks. So,
but you, like I said, the walking part. There's so much in our so many people in our community now walk,
mm.
and it's just
and I agree 100%. And Kippy was one of the things he talked about was that we could do this piecemeal and. For a lot cheaper than waiting around for a grant, which...
Whatever works.
I know. Yeah. Well, we should
I come
have
from
a
an
plan.
Industry, whatever works.
Absolutely.
That you do what you can do when you can do it, and believe me, I know that, and you know, hold off on certain things so till you can afford it and whatever, and you may never afford it, and you just wait till someone else comes along and builds a digester for you. So
one thing that we were talking about this morning was which parts of our town are governed by which are under full town control, and which other parts of the town are under state control. And one big center corridor is Sugarloaf Street. That mm-hmm. is a state highway. And Kevin Scarborough recently confirmed that not only is the state responsible for that road, but also the sidewalks on that road.
Mm-hmm.
We also spoke this morning. We were talking about the fact that certain projects that involve the state and the DOT won't get done simply by asking the DOT to do it, but require the political will and the political encouragement.
Mm-hmm.
Encouragement.
Mm-hmm.
So if you like walking on Sugarloaf Street and you want the sidewalks to be improved, call your state representative, call your legislator, and tell them, I want the sidewalks improved. This is a state road. Get on it.
What state road is it considered?
116.
116.
It's considered a 116 bypass.
Even though 116 goes on 116?
Yeah.
This is the original layout.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Through Elm Street.
Route 116 on paper is Sugarloaf Street, Park Street, Conway Street, and then Conway Street on the other side.
Oh, I thought it was Elm Street.
No, not Elm Street.
They never switched it to Elm Street? Okay, when they closed Conway Street?
If it were, actually, if we could get them to switch it to Elm Street, that would be good too, because then they could replace the sidewalks there as well.
I thought when they closed Conway Street, they had to switch it to Elm Street. They didn't?
We could confirm that, but I don't believe it's the case.
Okay.
Do they recognize it?
They do, which is why it was the state out there this week raising and fixing the drainage basins.
I know I walked by several times.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So that was the DOT.
Are they paving? Is that why they're doing it?
No, they did that work because the drainage, the grates were collapsing into the cisterns, so they had to. But if we get 30 or 40 or 50 people saying, let's fix this road, then we might get some movement on that. Or
actually,
let's
we
fix
are
the sidewalks.
I mean, that's one of the things on the agenda is to write a letter, start writing letters, because mm-hmm. yep. we have to make complaints.
Yeah. Because, like I said, it's just, you know, especially when you get out in the springtime, you know what it's like. You see the towns, you see what's mm-hmm. left over from the winter, you see all the, you know, all the things that happened over the winter. And, but like I said, I've been walking in this town for 25 years. It's been 25 years for us, our group, walking Sugarloaf in the streets and everything. And, you know, to see it the way it is, it's, you know, it's just not getting any better. And you want kids to walk to school safely, and you want elderly to be able to get out there and walk and feel safe. They feel safe because I think our town is protected, not that way, but safe just because of what's underneath their feet and above their heads, too, so. I mean, it's a broader thing than just the.
Well, we are addressing the trees, mm-hmm. and like I said, Jeff has heard from us that we need the trees done, so they are going to get done mm-hmm. Because it was voted at town meeting, and Kevin.
See, but you don't see that at town meeting.
Correct. Yeah. Correct.
You don't see that part.
The tree budget is only one small portion of the highway expense budget.
You're right. And you don't see that, so you don't know that.
For what it's worth, the amount of money that was finally approved was $32,000 for the trees tree budget, which was an increase over last year of $22,000. Kevin's request was $36,000, so it was the $4,000 reduction by the Finance Committee.
But was that taking down or replacing? Because I haven't seen a tree plant in this town forever.
No, it's strictly for management of dead trees and branches. Yeah, there's no money for a replacement.
We've used our tree budget for the last few years for tree removal, mm-hmm. and because we've had so much storm damage,
mm-hmm.
And it sucked up the entire budget. Mm-hmm. The entire budget, I think, Jeff, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's been traditionally around $20,000.
Right.
And
in the past, it's always been.
And we have exceeded that every single year in just storm cleanup.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, a little bit of preventative, but I have to say it's mostly was storm cleanup, you know, trees down and limbs down.
They're down because they're dead.
I know, but.
I mean, it's a vicious circle.
We were not adequately funding that line, and Kevin asked for the increase. Doug you said it was 36, and we got approved for 32.
It's still an increase from what he had last year.
Yeah,
right.
I mean, it's a significant increase. So hopefully he'll have an impact this year because, I mean, obviously you're hiring the bucket truck, and we had gone in on with a bucket truck with other communities so that there is a shared bucket truck so more of the work can be done by our own staff when available. And but the really tricky stuff, especially in Falls, property right. damage potential, you know, that's hired out, and that's right. what has sucked up all the money.
Yeah, I know Northern's gone through and marked a lot of trees on Mill Village that they're going to be taking down because of the wires.
The electric company's been stripping a lot.
Jeff?
The sidewalks with some of the power lines there, I believe those trees fall under your utility companies mm-hmm. as far as maintaining
right.
because of the power lines.
And that's what they're doing now.
Right.
Yeah,
so the town itself is kind of limited in that role
right.
as far as where those power lines run.
And Jeff is 100% right. We have made complaints to the electric company, to do maintenance for trees because we've, had trees come down.
Right.
Especially, it seems like Hillside has been tremendous mm-hmm. issues. That's been closed several storms mm-hmm. and minor storms. I mean, not even a major storm, just a little microburst kind of thing
right.
going through. And, I mean, there's River Road. River Road is constantly having right. trees come down.
That's what happens when you have tree-lined streets.
Yeah. And so we've been after the electric company to do those.
Yeah, but like I said, they've gone through and done quite a bit on Mill Village.
Yeah, and they've done Upper Road. I mean, Upper Road is vastly improved from what it was. But we'll all your suggestions are noted, and we'll
like
be
said,
as accommodating as possible because you are absolutely correct.
Yeah. But like I said, I think one of our biggest concerns is the looks of that Oxford Pickle site. It shouldn't be that way.
Kevin, I'm sure, is watching, or if he's not watching, this will be forwarded on to him. Right, Doug?
We will be, I'll be speaking with Kevin about that. I'll take a quick look over there tomorrow morning, and then Kevin and I will sit and talk and find out what kind of options exist. I know that he is talking about the fact that there's going to be some road work happening on North Main Street, some repaving, resurfacing, and there's going to be a need to temporarily place a lot of that material on the site over near the garage, but we've already talked about what that means in terms of where the material can go, what that's going to mean with the redevelopment and the resale of the Oxford property, and how that's going to work. So we'll continue that conversation tomorrow and try to come up with some answers.
But okay. Aren't there recycling ways now with pavement and all that hardtop? Doesn't Warner Brothers take a lot of that? And
sometimes they do. Sometimes the town can actually recycle it as well, mm-hmm. Depending on the type of work that's done. I'm not well versed in it.
Me either.
I do know that at least in the short term, as they grind the road, as they get that grinding down, depending on what depth the surface of the road is that they're grinding to, they sometimes keep it on site. Mm-hmm. In some cases, it's taken away and it's reprocessed and it's returned as new pavement ready to go. But mm-hmm. I'll get some more information.
There's a huge pile back there.
Already?
Oh, gosh, yes.
Grinding?
I mean, at the Oxford site. That's
okay.
A huge pile.
Whatever
it is, I don't go close enough to it.
Okay.
But it looks like they're, and it maybe some residents in town think that they can dump there, too. There's a pit, they would drive in trucks.
Right.
And there's stuff dumped in there.
Sure.
I mean, they dump on our property all the time, too. And it could be people thinking, like, you can go to the landfill and pick up sand for your driveway or, the town garage, thinking maybe they can also dump there. So, but.
Well, yeah, we'll look into it, Kathy.
There's rusty material out there and cans, and it just shouldn't look that way. Not with all that. And same with that walkway and that sidewalk.
We're going to have to take a look at the side. If it really is starting to really deteriorate, then there's an issue.
You've got pitting in it, and it shouldn't be. We noticed that last year when they first did it. And like I said, there's no grass growing and everything. I don't know. To me, the site, if you're going to spend $6 million for that garage and then try to sell the rest of the site, you got to sell it. Not make it look like a dump. And I'm sure the neighbors don't like what's happening out there either. In fact, I know they don't. The people on their street don't like what's, the way it looks. So
we'll consult with Kevin. We'll get some answers.
Yeah.
So next week, 7 o'clock?
I will do what we can to get a report.
Thank you.
Thanks.
All right, thanks. Approval of minutes.
Should have minutes for the 9th.
Yep.
And the 18th.
Did you have any issues or any questions on this?
On the minutes?
Yeah.
I didn't read them.
Oh, okay. Do you want to just hold off on them? We can hold off until next week. Doug, why don't we just put them on the table until next week, okay?
Okay.
Next item on the agenda is any comments. I just want to make a comment. I got a phone call, believe it or not, about Deerfield's position on bathrooms and stuff, and it probably was not very politically correct to me, but I said our main concern is not which bathroom you use. I'm not really, you know, it's not something that I'm really concerned about. Obviously, people need dignity, and I feel like whoever wants to use the bathrooms, use the bathrooms. But I did say that it was very important to me that no matter what bathroom you used, you washed your hands. And the person was not very happy. So
that's a great answer.
I just feel very strongly that it doesn't really matter what bathroom you use as long as you wash your hands. That's all we're asking. And so just in case that person decides to show up and complain, I want to just get it out there that that's what I said. I don't know if you had any other comments, Gabby.
I'm not going to touch that one.
Oh, okay. Board of Health comments. We have the mosquito contract that we're going to review, but people need to make sure they're patrolling the yard if it rains. You know, dump any kind of liquid that mosquitoes can breed in, obviously. But really, quite honestly, the real issue here is if you got to do tick checks every single day if you're going to outside and in the woods or in your yard and you have potential to get ticks. Right now, the nymphs are out and it's like a poppy seed. They're very tiny. I mean, they look like a freckle. So please, please, please check yourself carefully. One bite can change your life. And if it goes unchecked, Lyme disease is terribly unreported. We get Lyme disease reports constantly of people in town, you know, that are infected, and it really will affect your life. So just make a habit. If you're outside working in your yard in this beautiful weather, please do tick checks, okay?
I thought the Board of Health comment was washing your hands.
Well, that was, yeah. Well, that was a selectman's, that was a complaint to the Board of Selectmen, I guess.
I get it.
My complaint was, just wash your hands. Okay. The mosquito contract, there was our town council added some things to it. Did you get any feedback from Greenfield?
Yes, I did. The response I got back from Nicole Zabka, did I get the name right? That she was going to be presenting the contract to Mayor Martin for feedback and that she would get back in touch with me. I have not heard yet back. So you have two copies of the contract, the original contract as proposed, and then the red line changes to the contract. I think they're purple. Changes to the contract as recommended by our council. You can see that from page 2 or 3 on, there's a great deal that was added. Most all of it is boilerplate language that is at the bottom of every single contract. But the some specifics towards the on the front page, on the first page, relate to the term of the contract, the renewal of the contract, and the fact that it's the town's right to renew exclusively, and that there's no automatic renewal provision in the contract.
Why don't we wait until next week? I will try to get in touch with Nicole and see what the mayor thought.
Oh, right, exactly. That's what I was going to suggest.
Right, yeah. If he's going to sign off on our changes,
yep.
Then I will get in touch with VDCI and see if they will be good with our changes. Both municipalities were going to sign off on it.
On the same
contract.
And
then they'll... So let's just do this next week. And
well, I have a question about
sure.
it. This is an agreement for trapping mosquitoes?
They do the assessment. Do you have the original proposal? Because I don't.
Oh, have that's right. I just. But it basically is for trapping mosquitoes and then analyzing the mosquitoes to see if they have what diseases or any and all diseases.
Well, yeah. What they come and do is do the assessment. And
what do you mean by an assessment? Is they, trapping?
No. They go around town and say where the potential areas are, and we're I'm hoping the north end of town will have some donations to do some additional trapping up there. But so that most of the trapping can be down in here, because there's enough areas down here that needs to be trapping. And what they do is they trap, they analyze the what kind of mosquitoes, and they monitor and do the trending of the kind of mosquitoes. Mm-hmm. And then they also test for West Nile and Triple E. We do know that we have some reservoirs of West Nile in mm-hmm. town based on the random tests that the DPH did last August. Mm-hmm. So what this does is this weekly report, and again, we're hoping to have public outreach and information where they'll come in and explain what kind of mosquitoes there are, what does the mosquitoes mean, what does the trending, and then we'll get weekly reports. And if... Well, we have an issue, then what will happen is we can call people. You know, every week we tell people, dump the stuff, right. You know, use DEET, put on sunscreen, then put on DEET, all that kind of stuff. But if people know that there's West Nile or the Triple E, which is what I'm really concerned about, is circulating, then we can give notice so that people are more aware and be more proactive.
But I guess my point is that... Even if they identify 1,000 different strains of mosquitoes, to the average person, nobody's going to know. It's a mosquito. It's a mosquito.
But that's what we're going to have information about, Kippy, so that you will be informed and everybody else will be informed. What does the mosquitoes mean? Because there are certain mosquitoes that carry certain diseases.
I get that. But what I'm saying to you is that, you know, you, if you see a mosquito on your hand, you can't tell what kind of mosquito
it
is. You know, that's my point. And my point further goes is that, you know, even if every mosquito that's trapped has Triple E and West Nile and even Zika, what are we going to do, quarantine the town? No.
No, but Kippy, if there are diseases, you do stuff. There is action and there is mitigation. And that's the next step of what you do. I'm not a mosquito expert, but I've done enough research to pick this group that, and Dick and I had gone to enough meetings that I think it's serious enough and you have to be proactive and this.
But I get that, but what I'm saying is you can have all the documentation in the world. If a mosquito lands on you, you're going to have to assume that it's a bad mosquito and that you're going to have to be as proactive as you can. And I think you should do that anyways. I think that's the message. You know, don't take a chance. You know, you can't let the mosquito bite you, then try and figure out what's wrong with it. Don't let it bite you. Get rid of them. And I think that is a more beneficial, proactive way. And, you know, I don't see this as a prudent way to spend our money. I mean, like you just said, we don't have money to replant trees, but yet we're going to spend, this $11,000 or $12,000 first round. Why not assume that all the mosquitoes are bad and tell everybody, look, just be very careful, because all the information in the world that way is not going to benefit anybody, because we can't stop the people from coming to town or going outside.
We went to town meeting. I argued for this.
I know.
The town meeting voted it, and we need to give it a chance, and I will work very hard to convince you that this was a smart data gathering thing, and if it's not, then we won't be spending the money next year.
If it was to deal with, I'm going to just pick the topic of cows, if it was about cows and that, you know, because something that is wrong with the animal could taint our milk or our food supply, that type of information I could get. But with the mosquito, you can't, no one is going to be able to identify the mosquito that bites them. And like I said, even if every mosquito was tested positive for all of them, you know, what are we going to do? We're just going to tell people to be prudent about their protection.
Kibby, based on the trending, you trend what's breeding, the amount of mosquitoes, all that kind of stuff, what disease is circulating, and then you have a mitigation plan. This is really just have faith, okay? And follow through on this for a year so that I can show you that this is a worthwhile thing. This has been 2 years of working with communities up and down Pioneer Valley, going to meetings to try to resolve what we're doing for the mosquito thing, because mosquitoes are getting worse and they're carrying more diseases and our communities are at risk. And we have to do something.
If we're going to do something, what if all the mosquitoes that are captured have all the diseases? What would we do?
Why we're hiring a company to come in and help us decide what's going on, inform us, do a mosquito night. We're going to have a mosquito night, information night, so people can get some general information. It will be taped on FCAT. It will circulate so people can view it, you know, for the summer. And, you know, hopefully you'll be more informed and figure out how you can protect your families, because the problem is it is a risk and it's getting to be more of a risk. And we need data. We need data and hopefully if there's federal money to fight mosquitoes, if the Zika thing becomes bad or we get terrible triple E issues, we'll be in a position to get help and to help our community, protect our community.
I know that you're adamant about it, but I think it's a waste of money, and I just don't see that there's any benefit to it.
And we're not going to agree on this.
And like I said the other night, I'm convinced.
Well, but at the end of the year, that hopefully you'll have a different attitude.
I won't.
Or I will be agreeing with you that it wasn't worth the money. And
this is exactly one of the items that, you know, I spoke on the last couple of times, is that we can't just keep saying yes to everything, because that's why we can't save money. We just, every new little nuance that comes in or special interest, we say yes, it's a good idea, it's a good idea, it's a good idea, it's a good idea. Well, when does it become not such a good idea? Is when we can't plant a tree in our town, or, you know, we can't clean something, or we can't, you know, this is what we need to do. We got to stop just...
It's a public health issue, Kibby,
it's bugs.
We've got to be able to deal with bugs. It's part of climate evolution or climate change, whatever you want to call it. We've got to be able to deal with bugs better, and we've got to figure out strategies, and we've got to figure out mitigation plans. And it's about spending our money effectively, because if you have no information, you certainly can't spend any money in mitigation that is worthwhile and efficient. So to me, we've got water sitting everywhere in town. I get tons of phone calls about people complaining about mosquitoes and stagnant water. I have a highway department and Dick throwing discs out. We do record stuff. We do try to do a little bit. But guess what? It's not really effective. And it's not a plan. And these guys are... one of the best companies, the CDC just hired them. They are one of the best national companies. They have really good recommendations from the people on the Cape. And, you know, I think they're going to help us have a mitigation plan for the town. And they'll help us with public outreach. They have already public education stuff that they, you know, developed that, you know, why invent the wheel? We can pass out stuff. It's a lot more effective than patrol your yard and check water. Is that the number one thing to do? Yes. It's just like washing your hands. It's the most important thing to do. And you encourage people to do it. But if people know that it's effective, and that's, you know, it's presentation, it's perception, and you're trying to convince people to have good practices, and good practices is patrolling your yard, doing tick checks. It's we're trying to promote stuff
and
that doesn't count money.
I agree
costs,
with all
doesn't
of
cost
that.
Money.
I agree with everything that you said, but why we assume that ticks are bad? Not every tick is bad, but we assume.
No, about 50% though are in the town
they
of Deerfield.
They are, and I agree. Yeah. And but we're not out trapping ticks. You know,
no.
We assume that every tick is bad. That's what I'm saying about the mosquitoes. Assume every mosquito is bad. Do your due diligence. clean up your yard, help your neighbors. As a community, maybe we can clean up some of our own swampy areas to get rid of the mosquitoes. It would be more beneficial to do some sort of spraying or bug killing. At least you're killing some mosquitoes. You know, you're getting rid of them that way. Just to study them, I don't get it, and I don't think I ever will, Carolyn.
But Kibbe, the part of this information is to say, how do we need to spray? You know, and what do we spray? And is the lava side enough? Because they will do, you know, they'll put together a mitigation program based on what's happening in town.
But that whole thing just is so bizarre, because if you have all these mosquitoes over here, and they say, we've been monitoring these mosquitoes for 3 months, and you have a large population, we get a microburst, something to win, all those mosquitoes are now going to be over near my house. There's not going to be any mosquitoes here. So, you know, they just randomly kind of go, you know? I don't know. I just...
Well...
Okay, let's move
faith,
on, okay?
Have faith.
Okay.
And either I will be agreeing with you at the end of the year, end of December, or you will be agreeing with me. How's that?
I'm not going to go for this, though, but that's all right. Let's go to our next item.
Well, all right. Conservation District update. Doug and I had some conversation with Kevin. We're trying to find a way to match some money that has potential to fix some drainage issues, and we're going to write a letter to that. There isn't much to really update on that. I didn't realize you put it on the agenda.
Oh,
again.
I'm sorry. Okay.
No. It's just
a little bit more there.
Yeah. Well, I mean, we're going to write a letter to try to see if the state would be, because the permitting on 5 and 10. What this really is the landslide issue on Wapping Road coming silting in the property between 5 and 10 and Mill Village, and drainage issues and stuff, and we're trying to figure out how to address that, and there's potential that we do that.
Do we want to reach out to the various and sundry landowners that may be affected by anything that might happen here?
We have a pretty good idea who is involved, and I think the property, it wouldn't be a problem to work on the property.
Well, it's not a matter of, you know, getting a right to enter onto the property, but it's a matter of seeing if the property owners want to actually collaborate on the solution and help to put more pressure on the state level to get something done. Again, a state road where all we can do is put political pressure on our representatives, who can in turn, you know, get the DOT working on some of the solutions. So,
what is the? I'm a little bit familiar with that, but you're saying that the land is eroding from, is that Pleasant Street? What street is that up on top of the railroad?
Steam Mill
Road.
That's where we had that landslide.
So there's a landslide, and that's been slowly migrating to plug the drain that goes underneath Route 5?
It's actually the landslide. The state geologist came out and did a report for us. It's actually stabilized pretty good right now. Obviously, if we have tremendous amount of water over a long period of time, that it might be destabilized. But the railroad is checking it, and what was one thing, now that Sharon Zemek is gone, we were going to follow up and make sure that the railroad is checking either daily or every other day still the culvert, because what happens if that gets plugged, then the potential for the whole thing to come down on Wapping Road is tremendous. So we got to make sure that that gets checked on a regular basis. But what happened is, when we had that landslide, it came down, and Kevin was able to move a lot of the dirt along Wapping Road, and that got cleaned up. But a lot of the silt
just went downstream.
Went across the street, 5 and 10, and that whole area got plugged up. And we have, the reason why we want to write letters is because, you know, people's septic systems between 5 and 10, along 5 and 10, Wapping Road, are at risk.
Yeah.
And obviously mosquitoes, because the water's very stagnant and doesn't move, just because everything's silted in.
So are you looking through just the state highway to have them clean it up, or are you looking for permission through DEP
to clear
the drains?
Well, what we wanted to do was do a collaborative effort with the state, because state, every time it rains, 5 and 10 is potentially flooding. And so,
are you saying primarily because of that culvert there?
Well, because it's plugged, there's no water movement, so the water just sits and it pools there, and that threatens the septic systems and then also the passability of 5 and 10. So we're trying to get the state to work with us, and we did have them have a deal with us that they would do the permitting and we would do the work, you know, cleaning out the property between 5 and 10 and Mill Village. And so what we're trying to do is use funding that's available for the Deerfield watershed through our Resilient Communities Group and the Franklin Conservation District that I'm on, and match it with what's, you know, stormwater plan the Deerfield Academy is doing, and because unfortunately it's a one-to-one match. So it's $1,425,000, but you've got to come up with a $1,425,000 match. So, and the big, and one of the big expenses.
The town has to?
No, if you're going to utilize the money.
Yep.
It's actually not for public entities, but you public entity work can be used as a match. So we're trying to get the state to do the DEP permitting, which could be $100,000 or $200,000. So we're trying to get them to pick that part up. And they actually agreed to that a couple years ago. And
so the state charges itself.
Well, see, it's a wash for them. So I don't know how they do it through the budget process, but
right.
If we did it, it would be extremely expensive.
Yep, I get it.
And there's also, you would have a mitigation plan where you'd have to have them come and follow up and all that kind of stuff. So it's a huge long tail commitment. So we're trying to get them to do the permitting, us to do some work, and then use whatever stormwater plan Deerfield Academy is having with their new buildings and see what the total is and see if that would be enough so that we can access the money to get actually the project done. So it's a facilitating trying to fix that area, because that area, you know, is the culvert's collapsed. And if we have a storm, 5 and 10 gets blocked, and like I said, people's septic systems are threatened, that kind of thing. Next item on the agenda is a letter to Stan Rosenberg to support a budget amendments.
You have a copy of a letter, the last page in your packet. This is a draft letter that was put together based on a letter that went to the senator in regard to the state budget, the Senate's budget. They are deliberating that budget this week. There are a number of them. Actually, I think the total was 1,114 amendments to the budget that they are deliberating, and they're working through this week, and probably it's going to extend a little bit later. Some of these amendments did make sense to try to support. There were several others that the Mass Municipal Association actually wrote to the senator to support. But in terms of what might affect the town of Deerfield, I selected some of those and highlighted them. I would like to get this letter signed if you agree with these ideas and sent to the senator as soon as possible. I will scan it and email it to him and fax it to his office so he has it in his hands, because I know that time is an issue in relation to this deliberation.
How about the amendment, and I'm just glancing at this, the amendment for Western Mass EMS?
I believe that actually wasn't highlighted, but I think it might be covered under one of the things that are there in regard to restoring funding for emergency medical services. I think it's in there.
Okay. I think it was...
I was looking for that.
I think it was number 240, was it?
And that number sounds familiar.
Did I forward you that email?
Yes, you did.
Okay.
And I believe we've already actually sent a note to...
We have already sent a letter, but yeah, it would be helpful to reiterate again, because this actually absolutely impacts South County EMS, because this is the licensing of our all our EMTs and paramedics, and it also is they do the continuing education credits and all that kind of stuff.
Sure.
Otherwise, we have to take that on as fiscal agents, so this actually impacts our expenses.
Okay. So I could add that onto page one, please support amendment number 240.
Could you do that?
To restore full funding
And then I make a motion that we sign this so you can get this in the mail. Can you email this for tomorrow morning?
Absolutely.
I think they're deliberating right now.
That's, yes, they are.
I'll second it.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. So you're gonna you'll redo the front page.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I'll take
Thank
care
you.
Of it.
Yep. Sorry, Doug.
Not at all.
I don't think that it makes a big difference, Doug. But on papers like this, you can eliminate the Kip from there.
Oh, okay.
It's not part of my real name.
Fair enough.
Oh, I thought it really was. I don't know.
It's an idea my mom had.
Oh, okay. Structured tax agreement is the next one.
Yep, I believe you have a copy of the finalized structured tax agreement. And in your packet, I believe you have a memo. I believe you have a memo from the Board of Assessors basically stating that they have approved that. Yeah, that's it right there.
That's a memo, but where's
Oh, right here.
The table of contents on the front basically gives you a sense as to what the agreement talks about, all the various bits and pieces and parts and how it works. Basically, the tax agreement will provide the town of Deerfield over 20 years with the same amount of money that can be reasonably predicted that the company would pay anyways if they were simply assessed personal property tax normally. The only difference is the assessors have agreed to a schedule that provides even payments every year over the course of those 20 years. This does two things. One, it provides the town of Deerfield with two levels of security. One, we know how much money we're going to get every year. And two, we know that the developer will not request an abatement or appeal the assessment. That's huge. That's big. This also provides the developer with a financial security of knowing exactly how much they have to pay. Mm-hmm. Whereas normally that number could change one year to the next. And this is going to help them with getting their financing in order and creating models for the financial success of the project. If you look on page 13 and 14, there are two schedules marked Exhibit B that shows the payments over 20 years, totaling $1,240,000. And the depreciation schedule shows what we would get via regular personal property tax, $1.226 million, versus what the pilot payment is going to provide, $1.240 million, or about $16,000 more. So in the end, we're actually getting a little bit more money by making this deal. As far as the assessors are concerned, there is no downside. And as far as I'm concerned, I agree completely with them. So I would ask that you actually approve and sign this agreement.
I make a motion that we do.
I'll second that motion.
Is there any further discussion?
None.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Make that unanimous, Doug. That's very exciting that we actually have some growth in town here.
There's a place for you. And I'm sorry, I put the nickname in there. I apologize. No longer do that. I would like to...
Is there just one copy for us to sign?
Yes.
Okay.
I would like to acknowledge and extend my appreciation to the Board of Assessors. John Cadera especially did a great deal of work on this agreement.
We did a lot of research.
He put in a lot of overtime, met with the developer and the representatives from the developer, and it's just it's a great success. I'm glad we're finally getting to this. The town meeting on June 6th will be to ratify this agreement and put a button on it. So I'm looking forward to that.
Okay.
Thank you for approving that.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is your town administrator's report.
I will make it very quick, as I know it's kind of late. We just signed the structured tax agreement for Lake Street Development. As you know, the site has been cleared, and they are doing monitoring for stormwater and runoff, and they're keeping tabs on that. With the conclusion of the negotiations for this structured tax agreement, the last step is a town meeting vote to approve this agreement and then to approve the net metering credit purchase agreement. And I'll have some information for town meeting members so we can describe what that is and how that's going to benefit the town as well. As soon as those things are done, they're going to start building. They really need to get that project built and online and on the grid by December 31st.
Okay.
So they are going to be rushing. They're going to be moving. Speaking of solar, I wanted to provide an update on the Eaglebrook Solar Project. This is not something that comes before the select board. It's not something that you have a say in. This is entirely in the realm of the planning board. They're conducting a site plan review, reviewing a special permit application for a large-scale solar development in a zone that requires a special permit, and then conducting stormwater permit review as well. That information has gone to peer review. The planning board has chosen two consultants to provide peer review services for that, and their public hearing is continued, I think, tentatively to June 9. Officially to June 6, but because that's the night of the town meeting, I believe it's going to be continued to June 9, and please correct me if I'm wrong on that.
I believe that is true.
Yep. The hope is that the reports from the peer consultants will come in, that they will be clear, that they will say this is a great plan, that the planning board will say this is a great plan, and that the public hearing can be closed and a decision can be finalized. Because just like Lake Street Development, Eaglebrook is also running up against a deadline to get this project going and built so they can capture the net metering cap allocation that's good until the end of December, and their SREC allocation, which also is good until the end of December. So time is of the essence there, and I look forward to seeing the planning board work. I think it's going to be great. A quick update on the real estate sales of town-owned property. We are doing a phase one site assessment on the Coates Avenue building, and hopefully that will be concluded within another week or so. That's being done by a company called Cold Spring Environmental. Something which is coming out of the redevelopment funding that was provided for that property in 2007. So it's been paid for in that way. That phase one site assessment will basically say, yes, the site is clean, and then we'll be able to close on the property, and that property is going to be redeveloped for local small industry. We're very much looking forward to that happening. The purchase and sale agreement is with our town's attorney for the Upper Road property as well. The one on the west side of the property. We're still working on the east side up there. If folks have been down Sugarloaf Street, you'll see that the old sandstone and iron fence has been removed from Sugarloaf Cemetery. That is in accordance with plans and expectations by the Historical Commission. The expectation is that it will be replaced with a new fence, new materials, but it's going to have an old design, a rough-hewn granite post, and four side kind of diamond rail. It will very closely resemble the types of fences you see in Old Deerfield. And that was a lot of negotiation on the part of the Historical Commission to secure that design and to make sure that that's what's going there.
I was hoping that it would be done before Memorial Day.
We were hoping it was going to be for Memorial Day as well. However, the fence builder has stated that in spite of the fact that they ordered it 3 months ago, the posts are delayed, the delivery is delayed. They're hoping to have them in next Monday or Tuesday. I will be speaking with the developer tomorrow. Because broadly speaking, our contract with them expired on May 20. We're going to need to negotiate a contract extension with them in order to basically legally pay them. So I'm going to need to speak with them, and I want to get your permission to do that.
Yeah, obviously. But
I think we have to.
I mean, part of it was we wanted it to look nice for Memorial Day.
We really did. I'm going to talk with Kevin and see what we can do, if anything, to demarcate the edge of the cemetery for Memorial Day exclusively, and maybe there's something we can do. I'm not sure.
Oh. So, well, again, it's just one of those pretty things. It just would be nice.
It would have been nice if it were there. Yeah. Absolutely. A couple of updates. Folks who have been reading the papers know that we've got application or job openings available for a highway foreman / facilities or building manager. We are accepting applications with interviews starting on May 30. We have an ad in there for an executive assistant for the town administrator's office. We're going to start interviews on or about June 1st. And we are also looking for applications for an administrative assistant and I think it's assistant town clerk. In the town clerk's office, applications are being accepted through June 13 with interviews on that starting shortly thereafter. So I'll keep you updated on that. We already talked about the Flag Day renovation and how the we're looking for donations of monies or donations of materials for that effort. Please get in touch with Marlene Johnson or Sue Corey at the Senior Center to coordinate if you'd like to make a donation. And finally, I wanted to remind you of the calendar, just a few important dates. On June 1st, both Kip and Trevor will be going to the new Officials Finance Forum. That's at the, I think it's the, oh, help me if I'm, I think I've got this wrong. College of the Holy Cross in Worcester? Is that the name of it? It's a great center. It's a great facility.
June 1st?
June 1st. It's during the day. It's a Wednesday.
We still have a meeting Wednesday night, right?
That's correct. Okay. That forum is starts at 8:15 in the morning and goes to 3:15 or 3:30 in the afternoon. So we'll be getting back just in time for the meeting at 6:30. Yes, the select board meeting at 6:30 on June 1st. Of course, the special town meeting will be on Monday, June 6th, here at town offices.
And we also have, don't forget, the public hearing for the capital projects.
Correct.
At 6 o'clock.
Correct.
And then town meeting is at 7.
Correct. And that'll be happening, yes, at 6 o'clock. And a notice for the public hearing will be going in the newspaper published on Monday.
Are we meeting June 8th?
I don't think you need to.
Okay. We are, Kippy and I are going to go to the June 29th Mohawk Area Public Health meeting, and maybe even Trevor can, you know, go initially because he has that collaborative meeting.
Where is that?
That is, and you're invited to, Doug, if you want. It's at the Greenfield Country Club. It's okay. The annual meeting for the Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition.
Okay. I'll put that in the calendar, and I'll remind folks about that.
I told Trevor 5 o'clock, but I think it's actually 4:30. I the formal invitation will be coming out, but we have a selectman's meeting that night, and so we need to move it. And Trevor has his collaborative meeting on that night anyway, so I was thinking that we could meet the 28th. Do you have anything the 28th?
Tuesday.
No. Okay. So instead of...
The only question is whether the warrants will be available by then, because that is a warrant day.
Oh, do you want us to meet on the... I think there's something on the 30th already.
Well, you could also just... You could meet on the 28th and then just sign the warrants at the convenience of the officer, so
let's
you can come
that,
in
because,
on any time on the 29th.
I don't have my calendar in front of me, but I think there is some kind of county meeting on the 30th already, and I can't remember what it is. I don't know. I can't remember.
I'll have to check.
I don't know if it's a FERCOG executive board meeting or a SEEDS meeting or EADS meeting that I have to go to. I'm pretty sure I'm booked for the 30th. But I can't remember what it is.
I'll have to check. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Okay. A few other things I wanted to just make you aware of. As you remember, we are doing replacement of the cable television equipment in this facility, in the town offices. That's going to begin on June 13 and last through June 17, which means, yes, on the 15th, the fancy cameras and the nifty microphones may not be working, but FCAT is going to be providing television coverage anyways. It may not be live. We may not go live that night. And
so
I apologize.
Our meeting on the 15th? No, that's fine.
Meeting on June 15th.
Okay.
We may not go out live, but we're going to do what we can to make that happen. It gives people a reason to stop down to Town Hall and see us. Maybe. About the same time, FCAT will also be doing some equipment installation in the same facility, so the timing actually works out very well. I want to remind you that you received, hopefully, an invitation to a retirement get-together for our outgoing superintendent, Marty Barrett. That's going to be happening directly after the Frontier Regional School Committee meeting on June 14th, which is, of course, at Frontier Regional High School.
Where is that party going to be?
June 14th, Tuesday. It's a Tuesday evening. When? Where? Oh, at the school.
Oh, at the school party?
Yep.
Okay.
It's immediately following their meeting, which is always held in the media center, second floor.
Oh, I'd be so sad to see Marty go.
You have no idea. She's been a tremendous collaborator
and
confidant and a terrific person.
I think Jeff can agree with me that she was such a breath of fresh air to work with from a budget point of view.
She's got really big shoes, and it's going to be hard to find someone to fill those shoes. She's just
did
done
they hire
so much
someone
for the
to
that? Town.
They already did, yes.
So
I just... I hope it's not repeat from the last one.
On June 14th through 16th, I will actually be away. I will be in Boston. I'm taking a 3-day course. It's the Massachusetts Certified Public Procurement Officer course dealing with construction, public construction, which if I pay attention, if I take notes, if I study hard, at the end of it, I will take a test and then will be certified in doing that. That will actually complete a curriculum after which I hopefully will qualify for full certification as a MCPPO for Massachusetts, which is a good thing to have. Helps.
That's wonderful, and it's also required for us, so thank you, Doug, for putting this effort. This is the 16th through the what?
14th through the 16th.
Oh, 14th through the 16th.
Which means that I will not be here for the Selectmen's meeting on June 15th. Select Board meeting on June 15th.
That's okay.
Kathleen Dolan will be present to take notes and to make sure that you have the packets for the meeting.
We'll cope.
And I'll be sure that I figure you would.
It's more important that you pass this test.
Yep.
So don't get too tired.
I don't expect to. And finally, on June 21st, I believe that a Finance Committee meeting is scheduled for that evening. I think it's going to be here. It's at 7 o'clock. We already have a number of reserve fund transfers lined up and some regular transfers from one account to another to close out our year. There will be a few more, I'm sure, that are coming down the pike. Nothing unexpected, and I'm keeping Dylan Corpita in tune with what we've got. Some of these are entirely due to additional work that committees are doing, and so they've overspent their postage allocation, for example. So we need to just do small transfers. Legal expense is the only one that's going to be high. It's going to be a $7,000 to $8,000 transfer because our legal expense budget was only approved for FY16 at $20,500, and we're at $27,000 or $28,000.
We were just trying to save money. I mean, we had to balance the budget,
right?
And we were hoping that our expenses would be minimal.
It is likely, however, that that will not be a transfer from the reserve fund. It'll be a transfer from another account in the selectman's or administrator's expense. So it's going to balance out in the end.
I know.
And we're not spending extra money, I hope. The rest of the transfers are small, $2,000 or less. So very minor.
Yeah. How are we doing on the compact stuff, the finance stuff for the compact? Remember, we were going to try to get some information to the Finance Committee, so...
Yep, we are still working on that. I did have, I think at the last meeting, I presented you with some information, and I'm going to try to work to get some information to some folks on the Finance Committee. I'll try to get that to them. It seems like it needs to be a really big conversation, and I think there does need to be a study group to actually start to tackle that. We can't obviously have meetings with the Select Board and the Finance Committee and the CIPC and the assessors all in one room all the time to develop these policies, but maybe we can have select members of those boards to present a first draft, which can then go out for comment to these boards or committees.
What is it?
Financial policies.
Oh.
We want to develop a very small, very thin, very clearly worded book that basically says, here's what the town will do when it comes to capital stabilization accounts, or to use of free cash, or to making capital requests, so on and so forth. Even the budgetary process could be encoded in a policy. Big, broad language, simple language, not use this form, submit by this day, do it within 14 days or something, but basically policies to help guide everybody's thinking,
stuff.
Not necessarily to throw their actions.
But actually some stuff is forms, because we talked about the capital improvement forms, the kind of things, some of the information, historical information is missing. What the narrative, you want to have a narrative, space for narrative, and you know, some of that kind of stuff. And where did you get the estimate? Is this estimate off the state bid list, or did you actually go out and get three bids? You know, I mean, how much effort was put in? When you look at the form, how much effort was actually put into the proposal already? Is this just a guesstimate, or is this hard? Right. And then how do you prioritize? More information on how to prioritize some of the requests, you know, that kind of stuff. We started that process. So it is some forms, but the majority of the stuff is going to be process. And we need the finance committee to work with the assessors more so we can, you know, we have a formula. We should just at least review the formula regularly on how we estimate revenue. And I'm comfortable with the formulas that we use because they're rolling five-year formulas. But somebody should be reviewing so they don't get out of date. And we are using free cash to operate. Well, do we want to change our formulas so that we say we're not using really free cash for that? You know, I don't know. This is a time this year and next year, and it looks like the following year we have a little bit of wiggle room. It wasn't desperate like it was 3 years ago or 4 years ago. Remember when we had? I mean, we were really tight. So this is the time to do some changes, maybe bring in some new stuff, talk about how we're going to work on things, and then, you know, because we have a little bit of wiggle room. It's not desperate. We still don't have enough money, but it's not, you know, it wasn't like two or three years ago where we absolutely did not have money, where we had no money for trees. We had no money. I mean, we were cutting things right and left. And people didn't really notice it because we were trying not to impact services that much, but a lot of stuff didn't really get done. We made no dollar investment in capital projects, that kind of thing. And you can't do that for very long. I mean, you get caught.
No, it's not very you know, financially prudent.
No.
Not to save some money.
Is there anything else, Doug?
Actually, there is one thing. It came up very recently. And this is a conversation, the result of a conversation I had with Steve Schechterly, who is the manager of record of the Deerfield Spirit Shop.
Yeah.
He made note that on his ABCC license, that his address is listed as, I think, 20 Elm Street, which sounds right, maybe, kind of, sort of, because the Spirit Shop is kind of, sort of, on Elm Street, but the proper address is actually 53C South Main Street. And the reason is, apparently 7 or 8 years ago, Mr. Schechterly planned a move to a new facility, which would have been located directly behind what is now the ice cream shop, I guess, on the other side of the railroad tracks. And he owned that land. He was going to build a new market there and move his liquor license there. A number of things happened, a number of the plans changed a variety of ways, and as it turned out, in the long run, it didn't ever happen. But at the beginning of that process, he applied for a change of address with the ABCC, and it was approved. The only difference is he never moved. So I consulted with folks at the ABCC, and they basically said that we need to have a Form 43 filed with the signatures of the local licensing authority, you, and we need to submit that along with a no-money transmittal form, as well as a letter from the license holder explaining the reasons for the change. It does require a vote that you approve the change of address as a corrective measure to the license, but it does not require a public hearing. It doesn't require a fee by the applicant, and it just needs to be filed.
So, and can you use our stamp, or do we need to come in and sign it?
I think I can, yeah, okay. As long as you approve it.
All right. I make a motion that we provide a correction address for Deerfield Spirit Shop to the ABCC.
I second the motion.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And the last thing I would like to do, just for information purposes, is request an executive session for purposes of discussing purchase, exchange, lease, or value of real property. If you, as chair, feel that discussing it in open session would have a detrimental effect. And I can assure you that it may.
Okay. I guess then I make a motion that we go into executive session to consider the purchase, exchange, lease, or value of real property. Is that the one?
Yep.
Okay. Open meeting would be detrimental to the effect of the negotiating position of the public body.
I'll and returning the thereafter only to adjourn?
And actually just adjourning, right?
Yep.
I will. Okay, Kibbe second it. Carolyn Ness, aye.
Henry Camosa, aye.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
All right. We just.